I love that song because God has hardwired us for the need to connect and be community. And it is so wonderful to be here today. I am glad you had choices. You could have been somewhere else. I'm glad you chose to be here. It's wonderful. Pastor Eddie, good to see you.
Good to be up here.
Yeah, and Pastor Eddie is doing a real gift. He's helping out with the rummage sale this year. I got to tell you, there's so many moving parts in that rummage sale. How's that going?
It's moving forward slowly but surely. We're getting ready. Morella is excellent. She's on top of it, so she's really the hero. I'm just helping. I'm just opening the doors and giving a helping hand. So
that's good. Yeah. Yeah, well, you'll do fine if you just keep saying yes to Morella. But you know that rummage sale is really important because, as you know, Our school is our number one mission field. It is so important. Great things are happening in our school, and we've got a great year coming. And there are children that are not able to be there without help to defray the cost of attending our school. And so this rummage sale is one of those ways that we are raising funds for our children. So it's a worthy cause, and we'd love you to support it. And the technology fundraiser.
Yeah, the technology fundraiser. Exciting news. If you have seen the thermometer outside, we are at $21,700, I think. So you know, we're moving forward.
Yeah. As I've said to you, you know, when all that equipment was new, it was top dollar, it was top of the line. It is now antiquated, undependable, and it causes many extra hours for our volunteers to do that. I am so appreciative that our church family is taking care of our volunteers by funding this worthy cause to update our equipment so that they can do their job more easily and have more fun doing it. So good work. We're getting close to halfway through. Keep sending those dollars because they are making a difference, and it's appreciating the behind-the-scenes people that you rarely see unless you hear a or the lights go out or whatever. Then everybody looks back there, but these guys are so, so tireless in what they're doing, and we appreciate them. So you can do that by continuing to give.
And we did order the new soundboard already.
And I don't know what this next thing is all about.
It's about old guys.
I think the rest of us know what it's about.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, not in terms of my personality. I've never been really retiring in terms of my personality. But yes, so that, yeah. I guess that's self-explanatory. Unless anyone.
Yeah, June 12th. Sign up at the welcome desk. If you plan to be there, hopefully as many of you can come out and we can celebrate Pastor Rick and Cheryl.
All right. Hey, it's time to worship, and we have the Lord present here abundantly, and God is going to bless us. Let's be in an attitude of worship and praise.
That we live with. I'm singing, I will be your friend. I will be your friend. I'm singing, I will be your friend.
Amen. I would encourage you to turn to your neighbor and say, God loves you, and so do I. That sounded good. Vera loves me, or Vicky. It's one of them. Could be both. There are those that have said, who are those people up front? I figure you know them all, but I'm going to introduce you while Zach gives us a long intro that he didn't expect. Zach Parks is just sang and leading for us today. His father, Gary, was, I think, 17 years ahead of me in school, but I've known him for quite a while. Then the guy with the lovely hairdo that we're all trying to get him to help us with is Eddie. Pastor Eddie, you know him. He'll play cello and guitar. Nathaniel is playing bass, Nathaniel Norris. Brad Dutz is playing on percussion. Katie Hammock and David Futcher and me. So now I've identified them all, and next month I won't have to do that, right? But, you know, they all have a heart to worship, which is what we've come to do. So I'd invite you, if you would care to stand with us as we worship, or you may sit, or you may, however you feel comfortable. You've heard of worship unplugged. This is worship unmasked. Yeah, amen. Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in a desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out on, turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out on, turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed. My heart to sing thy grace. of mercy ever cease. Call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love.
In Philippians chapter 2, Scripture calls us above all else to get along. Paul says, if there's anything I can ask you, I can beg you to do, if I've done anything for you, he says, please get along with each other. This is so. Not only do we look forward to going home in heaven, but when people come to our community, they can look forward to coming home as well. That coming home to us might feel like coming home to people who belong to the risen King and to the kingdom here and now and to the kingdom hereafter.
Softly and tenderly Jesus is calling for you and for me. On the portals he's waiting and watching for you and for me. Earnestly, tenderly.
God, you are good. And we are grateful. We are grateful that you would be present with us today, that you would call us to be present with each other, that you love us today, and that you call us to love each other. Jesus, may we be representatives to one another of you. May we be so loved by you and be so aware of that, that you spill over into the way that we deal together. Jesus, we look forward to what you're going to do in this service. We look forward to what you have to say to us through Pastor Brick. We look forward to what you're doing in our hearts now, and we do look forward to going home with you someday. We love you, Jesus. Thank you for loving us first. In the beautiful name of Jesus Christ, the congregation said,
come home. Come home. Be seated.
You know, there's a tradition that says that in the early Advent movement, there were people that were converted just with the singing of hymns. There was a man named Frank Belden who is the most prolific Adventist hymn writer. And he would listen to the first couple of lines oftentimes on a sermon and know where the pastor was going, and he would go and compose a hymn for that closing song. Of course, they might preach 2 hours, so he had a little time to do it. But, you know, I just am so grateful for the gift of music that God has given us, and today we have been richly served by our servants who have been lifting up Jesus in music, and I just felt impressed that I just needed to say thank you to our team who has led us today. Uh-oh. Come on.
Oh, no.
It worked before. I think it went away. In a perfect world, yes. All right. There's a theme song for a long-running sitcom, Cheers. And what it was all about was a place where everybody knows your name and they're all glad that you're here. And this thing ran through 275 episodes. It almost was canceled in its first year. It started out in September of 1982 and concluded in May of 1993. And in that 11 years, what was it that captured the heart of America? It's kind of an interesting setting because it was in a bar. And here is this place where people can come and feel safe and talk about their problems and be able to be real with each other. And it says that the whole theme of the song is and of the show is where everybody knows your name and everybody's glad you're here. And if that's the case in a bar and that's what captured the heart of America, how much more should it be the case for our church? How much more should people feel welcome and safe and that sense of community and being family and being appreciated and loved and even able to be a little awkward at times? How much more is God's community called to be that welcoming place where people come in and they feel the difference They not just see the difference, they feel the difference, they experience the difference, and they say, I feel like I'm home. Now, that's not saying that we have arrived, but it is saying that that is our ideal. That is what we want Jesus to do in us as individuals and in us as a body of believers. And I have to say, candidly, that I feel that this has been such a warm church family. Such a welcoming place for us, and we love welcoming people into this family because Cheryl and I have a confidence that we know that people who come here love to be here. And I'm celebrating personally the whole idea that we are beginning to emerge out of the scourge of COVID-19. You know, it's not over yet, and we still need to be careful and use precaution, but it's so good to start drawing together as a family. Well, there's power in being accepted, feeling accepted. It's an amazing thing when you know that you're amidst of people who care about you and care about what you're going through. And you know, we take turns. If you're not in the barrel of suffering right now, you will be sometime. But if you are suffering, we want to be that place where you can come and feel safe to share your inner thoughts, your inner heart, to know that you are connected with some of the people here, that you can share your deepest pain. I just celebrate that today even today there was an opportunity to just come alongside someone who was hurting. And that's a good thing. We probably many of us know this pastor who shared this, but Rick Warren, and he says this: when you're accepted, it does tremendous things for your self-esteem. The truth is, Jesus accepts you, and that acceptance is not based on your performance. In fact, you have received Christ and accepted Jesus into your life. But do you realize that you're able to do that because Jesus accepted you? And you know, it takes a long time to come to the realization that God's love, Jesus' love, is not based on what we do. We can't do anything to make Him love us more. We can't do anything to make Him love us less. God's agape love loves us no matter where we are, no matter what we're doing, no matter what circumstances we're in. God's love is a constant. It is His nature. He loves us and meets us right where we are. I think Rick Warren has something really important to say there. And you know, it when we feel esteemed and loved and cared for, we are more likely to do the work of healing because we can be real. One of the things about religion, a formless religion or overly formed religion, is that we fall into the trap of trying to fit an image and put on this facade that makes us look like we've got it all together. And meanwhile, inside, as Jesus aptly said, we are like whitewashed sepulchers. Inside, we're full of dead men's bones. When we cannot be real with each other, we are building a prison for ourselves where we are slowly dying. The whole idea is that we be a place where it's safe. He finishes up, he says, you don't have to earn His acceptance and you don't have to prove yourself to Him. You know, I've worked for people like that, that gave me the freedom to fail and still accepted me and built me up. And that's the God that we serve, is that He is looking for ways to remove barriers and obstacles so that we can become all that He dreams of us becoming. And that's good news. That's what Jesus is all about. So Paul lifts this theme up of acceptance in Hebrews chapter 12. This is following the faith chapter, and many scholars disagree about who the author is. I believe it was Paul working in conjunction with Luke, because Luke's education and sentence structures were much stronger than Paul's. And so I think they collaborated, but it's definitely Paul's theology. And he lifts up this theme in chapter 12, starting in verse 14. And there we read, "Work at living in peace with everyone, and work at living a holy life." And I want to stop right there. Notice that the word is "work at it." That means, another way of saying it would be intentional. Make this a priority. Focus on living in peace. Focus on living a holy life. Now you say, well, what is holy? I mean, you know, we have a negative connotation to that, holier than thou and all the other things. Holy simply means to be set apart, to be different, to be set apart as God's people. And one of the struggles of the church today is that it is becoming less and less holy and more associated with our cultural changes that are happening today. And it's a real struggle. But this is something that is a one-on-one experience. God sets us apart as an individual and calls us holy. We are to be called and set apart. And as a group, we are all under His guidance. We're not on the same pathway. We're converging to Jesus from different places, and still we can be holy, right? And so that's a really important thing. So he says, work at living in peace, and it's living in peace. Well, that has a connotation of community, because we can be totally isolated and really be peaceful. But the truth is that we are always working in some context of community, and it is, as far as our part is concerned, we are looking for ways to live at peace with whatever circumstances we're in. And peace is so important, because it's the battlefield between our ears where the real turmoil goes. Our enemy, the devil, is always looking to stir up a storm in our brains so that we react instead of respond. Peace gives us that peace in the storm, in the midst of the storm, to be able to use the wisdom and guidance that God has given us so that we can make informed and wise choices. The biggest trouble I've ever gotten in is when I respond out of fear, out of guilt, out of shame, out of all of those negative things that get me acting out in an unhealthy way. And I thank God that I am on a journey where I'm becoming increasingly healthy in the way I interact with the world around me. And you know, that's the same for all of us. That's what Jesus does. And I love that what He does is from the inside out. That He changes us fundamentally in our core. And the scripture that goes with that is, God works in you to will and to do according to His good pleasure, literally rewiring our brains so that we see things differently, and when we see things and perceive things differently, we respond differently. And that's what builds community, because as each of us take personal responsibility for doing the work of healing, we become safer to be in part of a community. And we can draw together and be something special. Because, not because of us, but because of what Jesus does. And I'm grateful for that. He continues on and he says, if you're not holy, you will not see the Lord. Wow, that's sobering. If you don't take time to be set apart, you can't see the Lord. There are a lot of distractions in the world today. Many things calling for our attention. Many shiny objects, many emotions that we're dealing with. But to be set apart, in a sense, to be holy, is to set ourselves apart to spend time with God, to spend time with Jesus, to take that private devotional time to connect with God and process what we are going through with His loving guidance. That's holy, being holy, set apart. I set apart time in my day to be with Jesus. And that sets the course of my day. That's the way I like to start out. To be holy is to set apart time to be with God, to be with my Lord Jesus, to listen, to hear. Continues on then in verse 15 in the first part. Look after each other so that none of you fails to receive the grace of God. You know, that's part of what we're doing here. And again, Paul is so community-based. I love the authority of Paul because when in his previous life, he described himself as a Pharisee, as a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, faultless. He came from the tribe of Benjamin. He had all of the credentials, and yet he hated people. He didn't know Jesus. And when he met Jesus on the road to Damascus, his whole perspective changed. And what does he become? He becomes this person who is a uniter of two vastly different cultures. The Gentiles and the Hebrews, the Jews, bringing two vastly different cultures together under the guidance of the Holy Spirit and the love of Jesus. He was the one who wrote 1 Corinthians 13, the most eloquent statement of love I've ever read. And so I love that Paul has gone through this transformation. He says, look after each other so that none of you fails to receive the grace of God. Do you know what a gift you give when you extend the grace of God to others? When you give them the benefit of the doubt, when you encourage them, when you come alongside them in times of trouble, when you extend God's grace and loving mercies, we become a tighter and tighter community. And what happens in here transfers out there. That we are different in the way we connect with people. That we have something authentic and real. This world is filled with all kinds of catchphrases and snappy words and marketing tunes. And there is nothing that can beat the love of God as it works in us to make us different, to be set apart, to be something special. That's what God wants for each one of us. And, you know, one of the things that inhibits us, and it just popped into my mind, you know, Paul experienced very clearly that as he expressed the love of God to some, he was the incense of life, a sweet-smelling incense of life. To others, he was the stench of death. You know, you're not going to please everybody when you follow Jesus and are set apart for Him. And that's one of the things that kind of blunts our approach, doesn't it? What if somebody rejects me? Right? Yeah. But Paul says, you know, he says, go after each other and love each other and show each other the grace of God. And I think where Paul is coming from is that he experienced the grace of God personally. A murderer, a persecutor, someone who was serving God like the devil, to borrow a phrase. He knew how broken he was. And he experienced the grace of God at the low point of his life. And it made all the difference for him. You know, and it's the same for each one of us. No matter what you are dealing with, no matter what losses you've experienced, no matter what pain you carry, Jesus feels your pain, He cares about you, He knows you, and He loves you. And He says, you are mine. I love you. I never stop loving you. I never stop blessing you. That acceptance. at the opposite pole of this, as Paul lifts this up, we drop down a half a verse to verse 16, and it says, make sure that no one is immoral or godless like Esau, who traded his birthright as the firstborn son for a single meal. I want to stop there, because there is a picture in Revelation where there are those who are inside the city, the New Jerusalem, and they are there by God's grace. They are there because they accepted the blood of Jesus and his sacrifice, and they belong to him. And there are others that are outside the city that want to take the city by force. They want to earn their place in the city. And in that moment, it looks like that picture of Esau, who traded his birthright for a bowl of soup. And there are a lot of bowls of soup in this world today, a lot of bowls of soup that we're pursuing that are ruining our connection with God and with each other. Because so many of the pursuits are self-focused. A lot of naval observation. I need, I need, I need. And then I owe, so off to work I go. You know, we've got so much going on in this world today. And then it says, you know that afterward, when he wanted his father's blessing, he was rejected. It was too late for repentance, even though he begged with bitter tears. Let that not be said of us. We have this birthright that was won for us by the sacrifice of Jesus, by his death, his life, death, burial, and resurrection. He won our place in eternity by his shed blood, by his love that kept him on a cross. It's our birthright to have this. And yet, we can turn our backs on it. We can go for the next shiny thing and the next shiny thing and the next shiny thing. But there is such a thing as too late. Friends, I appeal to you. If you are going down that road, it's never too late. It's never too late to turn and take that which is really valuable, that which is really precious and true, to receive the birthright that God wants to give you. Living apart from Jesus. How sad. How sad that would be. When you're looking back from the end of your life, looking back over the years, wishing, well, I wish I had spent more time at work. I wish I had gotten that yacht. No, I don't think so, you know? But anyway, there's enough there. The point is that watch out that we don't fall into this trap. Now, at the heart of this passage, Paul shares this. He says, watch out that no poisonous root of bitterness grows up to trouble you, corrupting many. Notice that we are not living our life in a vacuum. When we have bitter roots, it affects others. We're not living in a vacuum. And you know, the truth is that we all deal with bitter roots. There are strongholds in us that started from some perceived wrong or a definite wrong that was done to you, something you were cheated for, something that was a betrayal, a broken relationship. There are many things that create a hurt, and it's like planting a seed for a root of bitterness. And that seed grows and deepens. And the more we harbor that resentment, that anger, that hatred, that hurt, the more we let that root grow, the more bitter we become and the more we hurt people around us. Because when we deal with things unhealthily in our own self and we're not doing the work of healing, we are becoming toxic to others. We are hurting others. Whether we know it or not, it happens. And he says, watch out. So this is another big alert. This is like news flash. Watch out! Because bitter roots are very insidious and slow growing, but they grow deep. And they're hard. The seed of bitterness is a hurt that is planted in you by someone else, by some circumstance, by some injustice. And we can get so trapped. Life begins to look very dreary. The joy, you know, you think of David, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. And created me a clean heart, right? He's talking about how have I fallen so low? And he asks God to do a recreative work in him, to restore him the joy of his salvation. Are you living a joyless life? It could be that you have bitter roots that have found their way into your life. And I want to tell you that there's only one way to kill the root. You know, you can chop away at the visible part of what a bitter root is putting out in terms of its plant and its bitter fruit. You can chop away at that all you want, but unless the root is killed, it keeps popping up. You know, anybody who's paying any attention to their lawn or to their garden or whatever knows that the longer you let a weed grow, the deeper it is and the harder it is to pull out. And when you pull those out, there's still a little piece of that root in there that grows up, and there's that weed again. And you know, in life, we can look at the symptoms. We can look at what we're doing, and we can chop away. I'm going to stop that. I'm going to end that habit. I'm going to, you know, and then chop away at what's visible. Chop away, chop away. And then that root just puts up, and it's very patient. Very patient root. But we need Roundup, and guess who Roundup is for the Christian? We need Jesus, right? Jesus knows how to take care of bitter roots. Jesus knows how to dig out that bitter root and kill it. Jesus is the one who can save you from your bitter roots. I love that. Jesus is so good. The eradication of bitter roots. It's time to eradicate bitter roots. Well, let's look at a couple different things here. Let God reveal it. If you're feeling, all right, so just talking from a personal standpoint, maybe you'll relate to this. Something happens. I start having a reaction that starts down here, right? And it starts coming up. And one of the things I've learned in my training is that I can ask the question, where is this coming from? And I'm asking God, right? I know the early warning system. I know what I'm going to do, because I usually work on a cycle, right? Stimulus response, and it gets ingrained, right? And I just do the same thing over and over again, and it's time to break that cycle. And I say, where is this coming from, Lord? What's going on here? Let God reveal it to you. And I think that there's a very important point in this, is that when we look outside of ourselves to God, He is our solution. Jesus and the Holy Spirit working in us is the solution to the bitter roots, that unhealthy behavior. The root of that unhealthy behavior. God knows how to take care of those bitter roots. He is our Roundup. And then let grace eradicate it. Lord, I know I've got this. You've pointed this out to me. You've brought it to my attention. I know I have it. And that's really the first step to healing, is that if you know you have a problem and you admit that you have a problem, that's the first step to healing. Because you can't heal what you won't admit to. And when we talk about acceptance, I'd like to turn this on its head, because the first thing when I used this phrase of love, acceptance, and forgiveness, I thought, acceptance is others-focused. And there is an application for that, but you know, I'd like to turn it on its head and say, acceptance in terms of me accepting my brokenness, me accepting my not being there, me accepting that there's something wrong in me. It's not until we get to that place that we are beginning the healing process. And when we confess it and give ourselves grace to let God work in us, it's a supernatural process. And the third point, let God replace it. And there's nothing that works better than displacement. You know, nature abhors a vacuum, and we can see this thing leaving us, but if we can replace it with a healthy response. And I've got to tell you that for me, I went through a period of bitterness. It started out as a small thing just recently, and I can tell you multiple different times in my life where God was doing this in my life, you know, where he picked his latest project. And that's an important point, because he picks the projects in his time and his order. I had this thing that happened. It cost me. It felt like disrespect. It felt like being ignored, devalued, nothing, that I meant nothing. And the deeper it went, every time there was another little thing, it was like fertilizer on my bitter root. Every time there was another thing coming from that source, it was more fertilizer, and the bitter root was going deeper and deeper. And pretty soon, I was finding myself jaundiced in my view of life. That's what bitter roots do. And I came to this place where I said, this isn't working. And I went to the source of help. God told me, I want you to pray for that person. So I sat down in my devotions and I wrote a prayer out and I sent it to that person. And I continued to pray for that person. You see, I displaced my bitter root with a healthy response. I don't know what it did for the other person. It may have had some effect, but I know what it did for me. I know what it did for me, because I'm a healthier person, because that bitter root recently died within the last couple of weeks. And God is faithful. Because when I finally really let that go, and it was a process of time, understand, this isn't like, boing, oh, I'm okay now. It was a process of time and being consistent in dealing with it each time it came up, that there came a morning where I realized it's gone. And then God poured out a blessing. I mean, he poured out a blessing on Cheryl and me. For one thing, I'm alive today. I could have been dead like that, and he preserved my life. But he did more than that. He restored far more than that. Friends, how many blessings are we blocking ourselves from by hanging on to our bitterness? If you have a bitter root, And maybe the Holy Spirit's touching on that right now, and it's stinging a little bit. If you have a bitter root that you're dealing with right now, I know a specialist. Our spiritual roundup, he comes in and he goes to work on that root. And he will guide you through the process. And he will free you. Because when the Son of God sets you free, you will be free indeed. And that, my friends, is good news. God bless you.
Get a little restless from the search, and we get a little worn down in between. Like a bull chasing the matador, is the man left to his own schemes. Everybody needs someone beside him, shining like a lighthouse in the sea. So brother, let me be your shelter, never leave you all alone. I can be the one you call when you're low. Brother, let me be your fortress when the night winds are driving on. Be the one to light the way, bring you home. Now there's a cage locked around my heart. I found a way to drop the keys where my failures were. Now my hands can't reach that far. I ain't made for a rivalry. I could never take the world alone. I know that in my weakness I am strong, but it's your love that brings me home. So brother, let me be your shelter and never leave you all alone. I can be the one you call when you're low. Brother, let me be your fortress when the night winds are driving on. Be the one to light the way, bring you home. And when you call and need me here, saying where you go, brother, I'm right here. And on those days when the sky begins to fall, you're the blood of my blood, and we can get through it all. So brother, let me be your shelter and never leave you all alone. I can be the one you call when you're low. Brother, let me be your fortress when the night winds are driving on. Be the one to light the way, bring you home. And brother, let me be your shelter and never leave you all alone. I can be the one you call when you're home. And brother, let me be your fortress when the night winds are driving on. Be the light to light the way, bring you home. Brother, let me be your shelter.
Amen. Oh, my dear friends, my brothers and sisters, know that you are loved. You are precious in the sight of the Lord. And he has dreams for you that are bigger than anything you could ever dream for yourself. He wants you to be free. To be free people, free in his light, his love, free to love one another, to lift each other up, and to grow closer and closer as a community, to make the difference out there, to make a difference where we live, where we work, where we play, where we do business. And so now, as you go out from this place, go as people blessed, people loved, free to share that love. Oh Lord, I pray for your blessings upon each and every one of us. And we promise that as you bless us, that we will be faithful to bless others. And we thank you in the powerful name of Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Amen. And all the people say, amen. God bless.
Brother, let me be your shelter. Never leave you all alone. I can be the one you call when you're low. Brother, let me be your fortress when the night winds are driving on. Be the one to light the way, bring you home. Brother, let me be your shelter. Never leave you all alone. I can be the one you call. Brother, let me be your fortress when the night winds are driving on. Be the one to light the way, bring you home. Brother, let me be your shelter.